sing about this amazing grace.
Mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter, the King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Today's scripture reading will be from the book of Psalms, chapter 3. If you want to follow along your pew Bible, it'll be located on page 448. A psalm of David when he fled from his son Absalom. O Lord, how many are my foes? How many rise up against me? Many are saying of me, God will not deliver him. But you are a shield around me, O Lord. You bestow glory on me and lift up my head. To the Lord I cry aloud, and he answers me from this holy hill. I lie down and sleep, I wake again because the Lord sustains me. I will not fear the tens of thousands drawn up against me on every side. Arise, O Lord, deliver me, O my God. Strike all my enemies on the jaw, break the teeth of the wicked. From the Lord comes deliverance. May your blessing be on your people.
All right, we continue in our time of worship this morning, thinking about the cross and that was the place where that transaction happened, our sin for his righteousness. Let's continue to lift up the Lord this morning and stand as we sing At the Cross.
There's a place where mercy reigns and never dies. There's a place where streams of grace flow deep and wide. Where all the like a flood comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin was white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. There's a place where sin and shame are powerless. Where my heart with God and forgiveness, where all the love I've ever found comes like a flood, comes flowing down. At the cross, I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you. I surrender my life. I'm in all of you. I'm in all of you. Where your love ran red and my sin washed white, I owe all to you. I owe all to you, Jesus. Thank you.
My sin, oh the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part but the whole is nailed to the cross and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, oh my soul.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well. Though Satan should buffet, though trials should come, let this blessed assurance control, that Christ has regarded my helpless estate and hath shed his own blood for my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well, it is well with my soul. My sin, oh, the bliss of this glorious thought, my sin not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well with my soul. And Lord, haste the day when my faith shall be sighed. The clouds be rolled back as a scroll. The trump shall resound and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well with my soul. It is well, it is well with my soul.
Lord, you are the only one that brings peace to our soul. This world is filled with sorrow, death, disappointment, injustice, unfaithfulness, slander, all kinds of pain. But Lord, you bring peace in a fallen world through repairing our relationship with you through your Son. So we give you praise today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. This time, let's continue to worship the Lord as we bring forth our tithes and our offerings and we sing the doxology.
Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Well, I just want to go over a few announcements this morning. Coming up faster than you might think is our Fall Festival next Saturday, October 5th. That'll be right here at the church from 5 to 8. We'd love to see you there. We're going to have food and games. The fellowship team would like they're organizing that, and they'd like you to bring a soup or a dessert, and I think there's probably a sign-up sheet going around somewhere, so if you haven't seen that, just holler at somebody on the fellowship team. I'm sure they would love to have you write that down. But everybody's welcome, and please bring some friends to that. We'll have pumpkin decorating and hayride and a pie auction as well. So come prepared for that. We are looking at next week, and during that, our church service on Sunday, we're going to be taking a special time to recognize, remember, and pray for peace in Israel, thinking of the one-year anniversary of the attacks that happened last year. And so in your bulletin, you have some resources there to help us remember that. And in addition to that, by the way, these are put out by one of our ministry partners, which is Chosen People Ministries. And so they have made some resources available. And these are free up here. In addition to what you got there, I've got a calendar, and I've got a kind of an expanded booklet. So if you'd like to go deeper than just what's there, I'm just going to have them up here, and it's first come, first serve. Just help yourself to those if you'd like to go deeper in that remembrance. Coming up, again, sooner than you might think, will be the Ruth play. And we need to know by September 30th, that's your last chance to contact Rosie about getting those group tickets. So please do that soon. On October 13th, we're looking for a few volunteers after church to help pull up some carpet down the hall. And in the fellowship hall, there is a sign-up sheet down in the education wing hallway on that bulletin board. So we'd love to have some extra hands. And then we are having Jim Halstead out on October 19th for an evangelism workshop. And I would love to see a good amount of our folks to take this workshop, because I think it's really, really going to be a good thing. And there is a QR code there on the screen. You can scan that. I think there's one in the bulletin too. And then you can sign up. And if you're going to say, hey, I'm not a tech person, I'm not going to do that, you just tell me and I'll write you down. That just helps us to know how many people to expect. But it would help you if you texted me. But if you're not a techie person, you might not want to text me. But I'll still
do my best if you tell me. And then last but not least, some exciting exciting new ministry opportunity for fellowship and spiritual formation and development. The Phelps are going to host a time of prayer at their home on Friday of each month, the first Friday of each month. And so that begins this coming Friday on October 4th. And I guess we don't have the slide for that, but light refreshments will be served, and that is going to be from 6:30 to 8. So first Fridays of each month, 6:30 to 8, and it's really focused on praying through the scriptures and seeing what God's word has to bear on our lives and praying those prayers. So if you have any questions, please see Ron or Angela Phelps. All right, I want to just commit some time to the Lord here before we dismiss our children. Father, thanks for gathering the family of God together today. Thanks for brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for a house of worship that we can meet that is undefiled from some of the other forces that might weigh upon our hearts and our minds this morning, a holy place that can be set apart for this purpose, for your purposes. Thank you for the organism of the church and how you've put it together to provide for needs and provide ministry opportunities and discipleship opportunities for mobilized efforts into building your kingdom. We think about this opportunity we have in a couple of weeks to come together as a workshop and learn how to be more missional, to get excited to live on mission for you. And I pray you would use that to do some revival here in our midst and motivate us and organize us. I pray that you'd be putting things on people's hearts who are in our congregation for new ways to be missional and to get the gospel out. And those ways that are organized and those ways that are unorganized, those ways that are personal and relational and organic and in families and workplaces and just wherever we go. Lord, we want to be a sent people. We want to be your ambassadors, your ministers of reconciliation. Lord, you've won that peace for us, and we desire that others might know that same peace, that they might have peace in their soul. Lord, I pray for the ministries of our church, from Sunday school to Wednesday night with Lighthouse Friends and adult Bible study and prayer and some small groups and the prayer, praying the scriptures that's starting up. Lord, that all these things would do their accomplished or their set out goal, and that they would accomplish that goal of making us more like yourself and having us to grow in Christ-likeness. And Lord, to hold fast to the truth of your word, that we might know the truth, but then we also might live it, and that we might demonstrate it for others. Lord, we have a mission to know and to grow and to show the love of Christ. So Lord, let that mission be accomplished in our midst. Pray now for the kids as they're dismissed, the King's kids, that you'd bless the lesson that they receive, that you'd be shaping these little hearts, that they might learn to be your disciples, that you'd bless them and that they would live a life of blessing because they've lived a life walking with you. We ask this all in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, kiddos can go to King's Kids, meet in the back there in the lobby. And if you would, please turn to the book of Romans and chapter 13, Romans 13. I would also point out that today we do have an insert in your bulletin with sermon notes, with fill in the blanks. If you are so inclined to follow along that way, you're welcome to do that. If you didn't get one and somebody next to you isn't using them, just steal it right from them. And that, no, You might get some attention to somebody in the back. Maybe they'd bring you one. I think we probably have a few extras as well. Or maybe you can share as well. Well, we're talking this morning about God's design for human government and our Christian responsibility to it. Our passage today exhorts us to submit to our governing authorities because they have been instituted by God to serve as His representatives on earth. We are charged with giving them proper honor and respect and paying our taxes. Laughter, no hurrahs. Well, before I read the text, I just want to say a few things that I think are important to set the historical context. Because I think there is a real temptation to hear a passage like this and to just say, well, this is the ideal. But Paul didn't have in mind this or that or the other. And lest we fall into that temptation, I want to point out just a few historical facts that help us to understand the context in which this exhortation to submit to governing authorities and pay your taxes and be good citizens and give proper respect. I just want to review a few things from the first century that I think will help us to hear these words correctly. So first, Rome was an empire. Oh, I should have mentioned those are the three questions we're going to ask today, but we'll go ahead and move on. Rome was an empire. At one point in time, it was a republic, but not anymore. It was an empire with an emperor, and there were mostly tyrants for emperors, right? It wasn't like as you go through the kings and there was good kings and there were bad kings. There were some good Caesars and bad Caesars. Depends on how you want to evaluate them. But in the things that we love, things like freedom and maybe we would not have such a favorable evaluation of the emperors during that time. So first of all, Rome was an empire. Secondly, slavery was legal and everywhere, absolutely everywhere, especially in the city of Rome. Third, Rome was what we might call literally a pagan nation. I mean, we talk about pagan nations today, but literally, the pagan religion of the Greco-Roman world, that's where the word comes from. It was an idolatrous nation. It was a polytheistic nation. It's not our ideal government that Paul is talking about here, the context that he's giving these words in. Okay, let's talk about morality. Prostitution was around every single corner. It was woven into the fabric of the society, as was homosexuality. We should mention that Jesus was killed by Rome not too long before this. The whole Christian religion came because Jesus was killed by Rome with the insistence of the Jewish council. But the Romans killed Jesus. Jews have resented being subject to Rome for centuries and have by this time had many revolts. Seventh, Jews had been expelled from the city of Rome numerous times, including most recently in 49. And we have referenced this a few times in our study of Rome because that's kind of changed the Jewish-Gentile dynamic in the church, because for a while the Jews were sent away into Rome and then recently they were able to come back into the city and things probably had changed by that time and the church had been operating without the Jewish influence and what happens now that there's Jews and Gentiles. But all that to say, God's people have recently been targeted and mistreated by the government. And eighth, there has, at this time, there was a public outcry over taxation that was recorded by Tacitus. And this was in 58 AD, which would have been after the time that Romans had been written. So it wasn't before Paul wrote, but that unrest would have been going on at the same time that would have eventually come in 58 and got all the way to Nero, and then he responded to it. So there was unrest over paying of taxes at this time. Ninth, Nero was the emperor when Paul writes Romans, and we'll look at 1 Peter as well. And Nero would become one of the most infamous tyrants in history. Now, at this time, to be fair, he was a young man in the beginning of his rule, and he was fairly, let's just say he hadn't kind of gone off the deep end yet. Okay, the fire of Rome in 64, and then the persecution of Christians around that time. But nevertheless, Nero was the one that was in power in this time. And both Peter and Paul will lose their lives in martyrdom under Nero's rule. And so if Paul's talking about being subject to Roman, or being subject to governing authorities, and if Peter in 1 Peter 2 and 3 are talking about it, and then they both end up losing their lives, needless to say, all this, leave aside any temptation to think, well, God wasn't talking about this kind of government. Because I think that we can all agree on these 10 statements, this was not an ideal government that this teaching came out of. Let's keep that in mind. And now let's hear the word of the Lord, Romans 13, verses 1 to 7. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and those that exist have been instituted by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed, and those who resist will incur judgment. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Would you have no fear of the one who is in authority? Then do what is good, and you will receive his approval. For he is God's servant for your good. But if you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath on the wrongdoer. Therefore, one must be in subjection, not only to avoid God's wrath, but also for the sake of conscience. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for the authorities are ministers of God, attending to this very thing. Pay to all what is owed to them, taxes to whom taxes are owed, revenue to whom revenue is owed, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. Holy Spirit, come now and do your work of illuminating this text to our hearts and to our minds. Reveal to us your truth and how it's applied in the context that we're in today. Lord, we want to remember that we ought to live in light of the mercies of God, and that means being transformed by the renewing of our minds and no longer being conformed to the patterns of this world. We're reminded that it means no longer being controlled by the flesh, but walking in the Spirit. And so I pray that you would form your people into a holy people. Lord, with you as our authority, but being willing to interact in the world around us in the way that you call us to. May your people be a beacon of light and live such good lives among those outside that they may see our good works and glorify you. Teach us your word in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we've got a lot of ground to cover this morning, so we're going to get right to it. There's not a lot of fluff today. We're going to move from point to point. And throughout, we're hoping to answer those three questions, these three emergent questions. What is God's intended design for government? What is our Christian responsibility to that human government? And then, when is it right to disobey the government? So what is God's design? Well, first, I see that government is supposed to serve as God's representative on earth. Now, that may seem a little bit oxymoronic, because government often leaves a poor taste in our mouths. And we see all of the places where it's inconsistent, all of the places where it is corrupt, all of the places that it seeks to subvert the authority of God. And yet, here in God's Word, He says that the purpose behind government, whether it fulfills that purpose or not, God's intended purpose for government is to be His representative on earth. Verse 1 says, there's no authority except from God. And those that exist have been instituted by God. And so verse 2 goes even a step further. So whoever resists the authorities resists what God has appointed. So it's not just the law of the land that we transgress, but is the law of God, as long as that law has not transgressed God's law. We'll get to that later, when it's right to disobey the government. But if it's not in opposition to God's law, or as we'll talk later, our conscience, then whether we like that or not, God calls us to submit to that and to be subject to those who are in charge. And if we're not, then it is as if we're rebelling against His authority, because that authority has been His representative. Governing authorities are His proxy. He's intended government to maintain law and order, to exist for the good of the people. And so since He's instituted that, if we don't submit, then it's as if we're not submitting to Him. Does this mean blind obedience? No. If we are called upon to sin, then we are no longer obligated. In fact, we're obligated not to obey the government that might lead us into sin. We have numerous biblical examples of godly disobedience to government, but we must understand that those are the exceptions. They're not the rule. But even then, we recognize that God is the one that institutes and establishes authority. And so even if we don't like the people, and even if we don't like the policies, unless it were to cause us to sin, it's our obligation to submit. Now, this representative is supposed to be for our benefit. Look at verse 4. He says he's God's servant for your good. And then it said again, for He is the servant of God. Twice authorities are referred to as God's servants. He's intended to do the work of God on earth. Actually, we see this in so many places that God establishes authority on earth. He did it all the way back in Genesis 1 with Adam and Eve. He established authority. He said, be fruitful and multiply, and He said, fill and subdue the earth. Adam and Eve were to take charge of the creation God had established. God establishes authority in the family, and He establishes authority within the church. And I think the same principles that we talk about today with authority, with the government, can be applied to any aspect of authority that God has established here on earth. That we are to submit to those authorities unless those authorities would lead us into sin. Because it says there is no authority except that which has been established by God. Well, what is the purpose of the authority? Number two, to restrain evil. And the government does that by punishing evil and rewarding good. Verse 3, rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. You don't have to be afraid. Again, this is the ideal. You don't have to be afraid of government if you do what's right. If you obey the government, then it should go well with you. First Peter will talk about how sometimes that isn't the case. And if you're going to suffer, it should be because you've done what's good, not because you've done what's bad. But the purpose of the government is to restrain evil by punishing evil and rewarding the good. And so likewise in 1 Peter 2:14, it says, be subject for the Lord's sake to every human institution, whether it be the emperor supreme or to governors as sent by him, to punish those who do evil and to praise those who do good. This is how they restrain evil, by rewarding what's good and punishing what is evil. Back to Romans 13:4. How does government punish evil? Well, God says that the government has been given the power of the sword. If you do wrong, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. It is the criminal justice system. In whatever society that might be, the government has a responsibility to maintain law and order, and that means bringing punishment on those who do evil. The fallen world that we live in requires justice at times to be established by force. And this force is called the sword. Now, it is not God's desire that justice be established on an individual level, person to person, personal justice, vigilante justice. Because vigilante justice is seldom justice. It's usually escalating revenge. And that leads us to our third point in God's design, that the government is there to enact the vengeance of God, taking it out of the hands of individuals. Verse 4 again says that the government does not bear the sword in vain, for he's the servant of God, an avenger who carries out God's wrath. Now remember, last week, or maybe the week before, we saw in chapter 12 that we were called to love our enemies and to not retaliate and to never avenge ourselves. Romans 12:19 said, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God. It's not our responsibility to do that. But how does God do that? Well, one of the ways he avenges is through the institution of human government that bears the sword to do so. Now, we might remember Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount said that you've heard it said, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, but I say do not resist the one who is evil. And upon first glance, we might be tempted to think that Jesus is saying eye for an eye and a tooth for tooth is not good. But actually what he was doing, and we did the Sermon on the Mount a year ago or so, so often in the Sermon on the Mount, what he's doing is he's confronting the way Old Testament scriptures and truths and principles have been distorted. And so in Jesus' day, an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth meant I've got the permission to retaliate. You do it to me, I'm going to do it to you. That's a totally different attitude and principle than what it was given in the Old Testament. Because an eye for an eye and a tooth for a tooth, if you go back to any of the places that it was given in the Old Testament law, the purpose was to have fair punishment for transgression, so that there might be a standard established in the community for punishing sin. Not to take personal vengeance, but so that things didn't escalate, so that the punishment fit the crime. And so God wants to take this out of the hands of personal revenge and give it to what is supposed to be an objective third party in the state. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord, but the governing authorities are to be his agent of vengeance. As a terrible thing it is to think about the sword of the government, and make no mistake, that sword of the government can be abused and misused, and could we say that maybe it's done so more often than not? As terrible of a thing as it is to think about that, you know what's worse? Is to have everybody do what's right in their own eyes. And that's one of the things, as you look at how God has designed government, and we can think of imperfect governments left and right. The absence of government is worse. Nowhere in the scripture do you see God advocating for anarchy. Even a fallen, imperfect government is better than no government at all. And there is a period of time that was characterized by God's word as everyone did what was right in their own eyes. That was the book of Judges. The very last verse in the book of Judges sums that up. After you've been through cycle after cycle of disobedience, of people falling into sin, God saving them, and then falling right back into sin again. And so, as imperfect as government may be, it is better than anarchy. Well, lest we think that government is only about intervening and confronting sin, let's make our fourth point here under God's design, and that is government is intended to bless us. It is intended to bless us by supporting morality and restraining evil and all that sort of thing. But I think we can also see in these verses that just in general, the purpose of government is to bless us. Because verse 4 says the governing authorities are God's servant for our good. And then in verse 6, there's a recognition that we pay taxes and that there's some benefit that we get from these taxes. Because we pay taxes to support these ministers of God who are attending to the public well-being. And so God does intend government to bless us as people. Well, if that's all true, if that's God's design, He's instituted it, and He expects us to be, He's instituted it, well, what does He expect from us? So let's talk about the Christian responsibility now. Well, first of all, we are to be subject to governing authorities. That comes from verse 1. Let every person be subject to the governing authorities. Secondly, and we got to go outside of our text to other parts of Scripture, but we are to pray for our authorities. God calls us in 1 Timothy 2 to pray for our leaders. He says, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. Okay, so first, be subject. Second, pray for your leaders. Third, specifically, pay taxes. It's mentioned specifically as a way to be subject to the leaders. Because of this, you also pay taxes. He assumes it's already happening. And he's explaining to the people why they do that. And then fourth, we are to give proper respect and honor to our governing authorities. Verse 7, respect to whom respect is owed, honor to whom honor is owed. If we were to go over to 1 Peter, by the way, sometime when you get a chance, read 1 Peter 2 and 3 and see how similar what we're reading here in Romans 13 is to 1 Peter 2 and 3. I mean, it talks about not retaliating, it talks about doing good, it talks about respecting authorities, it talks about... taxes might not be in 1 Peter, but there's such similarity between those two passages. And then fifth, as Christians, our responsibility to the government is to live in such a way as to maintain a good conscience so that even if we are slandered or maligned, Those who would revile our good behavior will be put to shame. That comes from 1 Peter 3, where it says, even if you should suffer righteousness' sake, you should be blessed. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled, but in your hearts honor Christ as Lord, as holy. In other words, God's got to be our primary authority. We've got to care more about what he says. And even if we're maligned in here, we've got to, in our hearts, set apart Christ as Lord. Then he continues, always being prepared to make a defense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you, yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame. Our conduct and our reputation should be such that when people accuse us of doing wrong, it's to their shame and not ours. Because we have acted in such a holy way that their insults and accusations are incredulous. For it is better to suffer for doing good, if that be God's will, than for doing evil. Number 6, our responsibility to the government is to acknowledge the ultimate authority of God and to entrust our lives to Him. And so again in 1 Peter 4, therefore let those who suffer according to God's will entrust their souls to a faithful Creator while doing good. We recognize that in living in the fallen world that we do, even as a law-abiding moral person who follows the law of God, we may encounter suffering and persecution. And if that be the case, then we recognize that the ultimate authority is God, and we have to just let it be turned over to Him. By the way, that sort of thing seldom happens on a big mega scale, but it probably happens weekly or monthly in your job, in your community, in the different places that you go, or somebody has maligned you, someone has misrepresented you, they don't know the truth, or maybe they do know the truth and they've distorted the truth, and God calls us to say, entrust it to me. I'm the one that matters. I know the truth. I know your heart. Entrust it to me. Vengeance is mine. I will repay. Would you trust it to me? Okay, so there's our responsibility. Now I want to get really, really specific. Okay? And I hope that several of you have the handout, because there's a pie chart there for us to give some reflection. Hearing what our responsibility is to the government, I'd like for us to evaluate our interaction with those in authority. So when we think about the government, when we speak about the government, what do we often do? I put 3 categories up there. We've been told to pray for those in authority, okay? But I wonder if often, when we think about the government and talk about the government, if we spend a decent amount of time lamenting the government or worrying about the government. I wish it wasn't this way. If we don't get this turned around, then this is going to happen. I don't see anywhere in any of the exhortations of Scripture of how we are to interact with the government where we are called upon to lament or worry. I do see where we're called to pray for, and we may very well pray prayers of concern, and we should, but that is different than lament or worry. But then there could be a step further. It's one thing to worry about or to... And it's another thing to complain about. By the way, there is this verse in Philippians 2 that says, do everything without complaining or arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure, children without fault, in the midst of a crooked and depraved generation. We spend a lot of time complaining about a crooked and depraved generation, And what do? We become the crooked and depraved generation that isn't standing out. So do we spend a lot of time complaining about the government? Do we spend a lot of time slandering the government and those who are in office or those who would seek office? So there is a pie chart there for you to fill out, and you can do that later today and identify it, color code it. What do I spend my time on when I consider the government? Of those three, God's only asked us to do one thing, and that's to pray for the government, and of course, to be subject to it as well. But my pie chart wasn't good. It was lopsided. It's supposed to be lopsided, but mine was inverted in the wrong way. And I asked for you to spend some time thinking about that this afternoon and then figure out what steps that you might need to take if there's any changes that need to be made. Okay, so we've talked about God's design, then we've talked about our responsibility, and now we need to get to a very important topic, which is godly disobedience to the government. When is it right to disobey the government? Because this passage could be narrowly interpreted to see that it's never right to disobey the government, that whatever the government says is that we need to do. I mean, after all, it says that the government is there by God's authority and he's a representative, and if we reject that authority, then we're rejecting God. Well, Peter is talking about in the ideal sense that is not true when that government authority transgresses the law or is calling us to get into sin. So we actually see two examples of when we are actually called upon to disobey any authority, whether that is government, whether that is your job. Again, some of these principles about authority, we probably come into that quite often in our jobs, if we were to truly be honest, or someone asks us to do something unethical. Just a little bit unethical. Is there such a thing as a little bit unethical? Well, any authority that contradicts God's law must be disobeyed in that. In that item. Doesn't say you got to disobey everything. But if they are calling us to do something that is inappropriate, that would lead us into sin, then we are obligated not to do that because, as Peter and John said, we must obey man rather than God. God's law and man's law are at odds, and man's law does not take authority. Because, after all, that man's law is supposed to be in subjugation to God's law. He's the ultimate authority. So wherever man's law is off base, we can reject that and make sure that we do what God has told us to do. We can see this in Exodus 1 with the Hebrew midwives. They were told to kill the babies, and they went ahead and made sure that the babies were protected and delivered the babies. And they told, well, the Hebrew women, they're quick in labor. Sorry, we didn't get there in time. They preserved life because that was what was right to do. They forbid even the highest authority, Pharaoh, in their land. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were thrown into the fiery furnace because they disobeyed. Daniel and Daniel 6, I think last week I said it was Nebuchadnezzar, but it was actually Darius that they disobeyed, that he disobeyed. When he was and he openly prayed to God when he was forbidden to do so. And then, of course, Peter and John, they were spreading the gospel message, and they were told to be quiet about it. And when they were told to be quiet, they said, we must obey God rather than men. And then, lo and behold, a few days later, they were brought back, and they said, well, we told you not to do this. And they said, well, we told you we must obey God rather than man. So the first one is pretty obvious. Any point where God's law or man's law contradicts God's law, we must obey. We must disobey the governing authorities. But secondly, when man's law conflicts with our conscience, this is a little bit trickier to perceive. And the reason I say that is Romans 14:23 tells us that whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. So there is such a thing as matters of conscience for the believer. And we'll get into this when we get into Romans 14. You might remember that the issue in Romans 14 is the weaker brother and the stronger brother, and the issue of eating meat and whether it had been sacrificed to idols or not. And Paul talks about the weaker brother, who is the one who can't eat the meat because it would go against his conscience, but the stronger brother is the one who can because for him it's not an issue. And he's giving instruction as to how to function together as a family and not a family of God and not judge each other. But whether or not it's right to eat that meat or not, Paul says, well, it actually comes down to Christian freedom and individual Christian conscience. So for this person, it might be okay to eat this meat, not knowing where it came from. But for this person, if it's bothering their conscience, and they're not sure about it, and it's not done in faith, then he's saying, don't do it. Because, so he said, whoever has doubts is condemned if he eats, because the eating is not from faith, for whatever does not proceed from faith is sin. And so it's a matter of conscience. There are black and white things, and there are some things that are a little bit ambiguous that maybe for some people is okay and some for not. You know, we might think about some specific examples. I know believers who have a very strong feeling that for them it's wrong to drink alcohol. Does Scripture say that it's wrong to drink alcohol? It does not. Jesus turned water into wine, which is alcohol. Paul tells Timothy to have a little wine for his stomach. Is it wrong for some people to drink alcohol? I believe that it is. Because in their conscience, God has given them a conviction that this is not right for me to do. If the government were to say, everybody must drink alcohol, for many of us, that wouldn't be a problem. But for some of us, it may. Because they have a personal conviction in their conscience that for me, that's not right to do. But here's the thing about conscience. It can be distorted and twisted to suit our purposes, can it? Can it then become our justification for doing what we want to do? As a minister, I have the option to opt out of Social Security. You're given that option once at the beginning of your ministry. And what you decide, you have to live with the rest of your life. Ministers can be exempt from Social Security. To do that, you have to say that your religious beliefs prohibit you from entering into this large insurance, basically this insurance policy of Social Security. Now, Social Security as an investment is probably not a good one, especially for people of my generation. Is it against my conscience? No. So I'm in Social Security because it was not a matter of conscience for me. Could I have twisted it and said, it's not a good use of money, and you know, so it goes. But that wasn't the question. Do my religious beliefs tell me that the wages that I earn shouldn't go to support this? No, I don't, because for one reason, I've worked other jobs and paid into it before. So anyway, all that to say, we have opportunities to be true to our conscience, and we also have opportunities to use our conscience for an excuse. So, you know, I don't get to decide what I think is right or wrong. It's not just about that, but it's about what is sin or not. Okay? So maybe you've got a conviction that, well, it's my land. I can hunt whatever's on my land any time of the year. I can take as many animals as I want. It's my land. People have been doing that for centuries. It's not right for the government to tell me what I can do and what I can't do. Well, that might be your conviction, and that might be you think it, what is right or what's wrong. But to say that's a matter of conscience, is it sin for you to obey the government and what they ask you to do? That's what we're talking about with conscience. That's the test. If obeying the government would cause me to sin. It's not whether I like it or not. It's not whether I agree with it or not. I can't just decide that, well, I don't think it's right that the government would limit the speed limit to 55 miles an hour. That is infringing upon my personal freedom. After all, I've got this six-speed Mini Cooper that it can do 150. It's limiting. I bought this thing. I want to use it. We looked at a Mini Cooper this week. My kids were all into it. We're not getting a Mini Cooper. For one thing, I can't drive a six-speed. Christina wants to. We can't use our conscience as justification to disobey the government. It has to be a real issue between us and God that says, for me to do this would be wrong. Not, I don't like this law. So this morning, one more thing. When we consider, we've considered a few examples of disobedience of government, but it's also worth noting that we have some very loud examples of obedience and submission to government, even governments that are less than perfect, or we might even say evil. David and Saul. David's submission to Saul after he had already been anointed king, after Saul had already disqualified himself, after Saul was after him and mistreating him, and he could, what did he say? I can't bring my hand against the Lord's anointed. That should speak volumes to us. Even when things aren't right, there is a certain respect that we're to have with people in authority, whether they be in the White House or in the corner office or in any other institution, because every institution has been, authority has been instituted by God. And then you got Paul and Peter, who wrote for us these two passages that we take so much about. And both of them will lose their lives to Nero. So, either this isn't God's word and that was their mistaken pie-in-the-sky philosophy at the time, and if they would have written it after 10 years later, they would have never written it. We could say that we want. Or this is God's word given in that context, and it's true. Even in those evil regimes. So this morning, to sum up, I think what we've seen is that God has designed human government to be his representative on earth. That Christians are expected to submit to governing authorities unless doing so would require sin. And that Christians are to give proper honor to leaders and pay taxes. Let's take that pie chart and let's make it solidly one color, which is to pray for our leaders. And let's live such good lives among the Gentiles that they see our good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits. And let's live such good lives in the world that we're living in that if we are to be reviled and slandered, that it would be to the shame of those who would say such ridiculous things. But most importantly, let's recognize that God is the ultimate authority, and that under Him are these other authorities, and that we will obey them and submit to them as long as whatever they ask us to do is not in violation of His law or of our true Christian conscience. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You for government. I know it's almost an aspirational thing to say sometimes. We're not truly thankful for it, and yet we don't know what it's like to be without it. We have no idea what the world would be like without Your representatives restraining evil and promoting good. Lord, we would pray specifically for our government, that where those areas of value are out of place, promoting the wrong things, punishing the wrong things, Lord, that You would bring change. Lord, we pray for our land, that we would put You in the primary source of authority, and that all other subsequent authorities would serve You. Lord, we pray that our government would be for the blessing of the people. Lord, we pray against distortions. We pray against corruptions. We pray against deceit. We pray against the building of earthly kingdoms and selfishness and power. And Lord, we pray that You would be glorified in Your people. Lord, we pray specifically for our election this year, from the presidential race all the way down to the local race, that You would put people in positions who would serve as Your agents of wrath, to maintain justice where need be, but also Your ministers of blessing to Your people, attending to the things that they need to attend to. And Lord, we pray for the purity of Your church, that we might not be pushed to the left or to the right, that we might not walk in the wide way, but that we would walk the narrow path in Christ-likeness, in peace, in humility, in truth, in steadfastness. Lord, be glorified. That's our heart's desire. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our last song is not one we've done very often, but we have done it before. And it kind of was chosen echoing back all the way to Romans 12:1 that says, in view of the mercy of God, present yourselves as living sacrifices, holy and pleasing to Him. And so the chorus says that, this is my offering. I'll give You my life, for it's all I have to give. Let's stand and offer our lives to our great God.
magnificent Holy Father. I stand in awe of what I see, of all the things you have created. Still you choose to think of me. Who am I that you should suffer your very life to set me free? The only thing that I can give you is the life you gave to me. Because you gave your life for me. I stand before you at this altar. So many have given you more.
Take our lives, let them be consecrated for you. Lord, bless your people, work in us and through us. Lord, let us be the light of the world and the salt of the earth. Let us go into dark places and represent you as you truly are. Lord, may you win people to yourself, and may you preserve the purity of your bride. Bless each one here, bless their families, bless their endeavors. Bless them for your name's sake. In Jesus' name that we ask. Amen. God bless. Have a great week.